Hello, everyone. Mr. Mooma here, welcoming you back for another tour through U.S. history. Today, we're going back to the video format. I would have been live tomorrow, but we have parent conference day here up here at Great Collegiate Academy. So I won't be able to do that. What I am going to be able to do today, though, is take you on a tour through the very fun Great Depression. Well, it's not really very fun, but that's what we're going to be talking about today. I'm going to get right into it because it's a big subject. I want to make sure I cover it thoroughly in as concise a format as possible. I've been having these down to about 35, 36 minutes, something like that. And I'm trying to keep it that way because that gives you time to watch it and then discuss it with your classmates and everything like that. So hopefully I'll be able to get through it this quick this time. All right, so to begin with, we talked about, you know, the 1920s, things are riding high, things are going great, and then all of a sudden the bottom falls out. The stock market crashes. Why do stock markets crash? Well, investing stocks is a gamble. You put your money in, you buy stocks because you think the price is going to go up, you sell stocks because you think the price is going to go down. You're only as successful as your information is. Knowing things before other people helps you out. In this time, you have a lot of ways to kind of game the system, insider trading, getting information before other people do, acting on it, shady deals, borrowing money to buy stocks, all kinds of things. And the more things you bring into this financial web you're constructing, the bigger effect it has when the whole thing falls apart. Exactly why the stock market falls apart, historians still debate to this day. Milton Friedman won the Nobel Prize in economics for talking about why the stock market fell apart. He blamed the Fed, Federal Reserve, and their interest rates manipulation caused this problem. But more than anything, a lot of it's just a result of a lack of confidence. People start selling, and then more people start selling, and eventually everybody loses faith in the system. One thing about economics that's important to remember is that it's all just a game of make-believe. It's all fantasy. We all agree to pretend that that dollar is worth something that it actually really isn't. It has the value we assign it in the rules of the game we construct that we call economics. Now, Black Tuesday, October 1929, the whole thing falls apart. Stock market crashes because all the banks are tied in with it, with all the loans they gave, you know, trade, everything. Everything falls apart. After this, America rolls right into 25% unemployment, factories close, people can't collect rents, cities can't collect taxes. The whole financial system just crashes. And this kickstarts the Great Depression, the greatest economic disaster in world history. And this is what, I mean, apart from the horrific damage it causes to the economy, both in America and the world at large, it also pretty much destroys Herbert Hoover's presidency. This should have been his moment to shine. He had all kinds of plans. He was an engineer. The idea that Herbert Hoover is this laissez-faire, leave the economy alone type guy is completely false. Herbert Hoover had all kinds of plans for fixing things and changing things and tweaking the economy to try to bring it around, and all of them failed. One thing that you'll discover as you get older is that the grown-ups you trust to run things so well oftentimes don't really have all the answers they seem to. And that's true at the highest levels. The smartest people in the world did not see this coming, just like the smartest people in the world did not see the 2008 housing crash coming. Economics is something that, despite all the genius in the world, no one can really seem to get a handle on because it involves mass human psychology. And nothing in the universe is less predictable than a human being. So Herbert Hoover's presidency just comes crashing down as a result of this. All over America, people, like Theodore Roosevelt said, when a man loses his money, he lashes out like a wounded snake. You step on a snake, it just strikes at whatever's close by, and whatever's most conspicuous. And that's Herbert Hoover. He's conspicuous, and people blame him for this. When you're at the top, that's just what happens. Herbert Hoover's political enemies capitalize on this. One thing that you see Hoover things develop all the, Hoover flag is when you turn out your pocket, so you can see like the little, pocket. Herbert, you turn out your pocket like that, it's your Hoover flag. A Hoover blanket is a newspaper laid across your face when you sleep on a park bench. When I was a kid in the 80s, you could still get comedy mileage on sitcoms out of a newspaper on a bum's face, that kind of thing. And of course, Hooverville. A Hooverville is a shanty town. It's a place where people who are made newly homeless by the Great Depression congregate. They put together some boards and tin roofs and just make their own little neighborhood, and is emblematic of a just downslide in America. America is a place where things always go up. America is a place where people are always making money. That's the myth. That's the story we tell ourselves. And so failing financially in America is way worse than failing anywhere else, because in America, anybody can make it. So if you haven't made it, you know, that's something wrong with you. So a lot of people are in a real bad spot as a result of this, and they're in a real bad spot really quickly. Well, one thing I should point out, and it's kind of a rough segue into this, but one thing I should point out that people might think is kind of odd is that what you don't see in the Great Depression is a massive increase in crime. That doesn't happen. Certain kinds of crime you do see an increase. For example, interstate bank robberies, interstate robberies in general. The new age of the automobile, coupled with the ready availability of high-capacity firearms and desperate men and women, make it, and also the lack of a national police force, make it an attractive thing. Get in a car in Oklahoma, drive down to Texas, rob a little local town, town bank, walk in with your Thompson submachine gun, blast a few rounds in the ceiling, get the money, walk outside. Here's the local, the cop, with his little 38 special. You just lay waste to anything he puts in front of you and just drive off to the next town. Communications between police departments, it's just they never see you coming. You go from town to town like that. And a number of famous people, criminals romanticized by the media during this period, probably you get like Bonnie and Clyde, for example, who are famous simply because it's a man and a woman out robbing people. They were never anything more but the most petty of criminals, and yet the media hypes them up like they're this sort of Romeo and Juliet of, you know, robbery. Pretty Boy Floyd, Machine Gun Kelly, Babyface Nelson, John Dillinger, all these guys get hyped up by the media, and this interstate robberies become a concern for the public simply because people, it's all of a sudden now because the media are aware of this menace in their midst. And that's where you see the establishment of the FBI, America's federal, basically, police force that enforces federal laws. The FBI comes into being for that reason, to deal with these violations of federal crimes. The FBI is not state police. They don't arrest people for murder or anything like that unless there's some kind of violation also of federal law. J. Edgar Hoover is the guy who really makes all this happen. He becomes director of the FBI. He's the guy who guides the FBI through some of its early massive failures. Their attempts to catch Bonnie and Clyde and John Dillinger and these other people don't end well at first. A lot of embarrassment for the agency, which means pretty much that when they do catch these people, they're not taking them alive. Bonnie and Clyde are shot to death under circumstances that today would be considered murder. John Dillinger, set up by his girlfriend, shot to death in an alley. There's no freeze, there's no stop. It's just, they just kill these people. And now I talk about J. Edgar Hoover in particular because he's going to pop up again and again and again throughout the rest of American history because he's FBI director for a long time. He comes in when, Hoover's president, FDR's president. But he comes in when, in the early 30s, and he's there until the 1970s. Why does he stay so long? Well, the FBI not only investigates interstate crime, it's also a domestic intelligence organization. J. Edgar Hoover has information on everyone. Not necessarily enough to put people in jail, but certainly enough to embarrass powerful people. And so most people just prefer to have him in the FBI looking out than, outside the government looking in. So he'll be in power for a long time, and we're going to see his name pop up over and over and over again. Now, so bad news for Hoover. I should point out that Herbert Hoover and J. Edgar Hoover are not related. That actually came up, and it's just odd coincidence. Anyway. So Herbert Hoover is out. He just basically really has no chance of winning re-election. It's a Democrats' election to lose. And they decide to go. They haven't had anybody really elected solidly president since, Grover Cleveland. Woodrow Wilson got in, but Woodrow Wilson kind of got in on a fluke because there were basically two Republicans running, Theodore Roosevelt and William Howard Taft. So Democrats want to win the 1932 election, and they run a Roosevelt, Franklin Roosevelt, from the famous Roosevelt family. Franklin Roosevelt, from the Democrat branch of the Roosevelt family, he and Theodore Roosevelt are distant cousins. He marries Theodore Roosevelt's niece, Eleanor Roosevelt, the daughter of Theodore Roosevelt's older brother, Elliot. And very different character than Theodore in a lot of ways. Theodore Roosevelt's this kind of manly man, outdoorsy guy, that type of thing. Franklin Roosevelt's athletic, but he is not a hunter. He's not an outdoor. He's not an explorer. He's not, you know, anything like that. He's raised in spectacular wealth from one of America's oldest leading families. When he's growing up, his Theodore Roosevelt, who's a generation older than him, is in the presidency. He plays with the Roosevelt children, Theodore Roosevelt's children. Grows to Harvard, gets a lot of gentleman C's in history. Gentleman C is what you, yeah, he's a good boy from a good family. We're going to fail him, but he's not really bright enough for an A. So let's give him a C, gentleman C. Gets married and goes into law, but never really does any actual productive work in his life. He's just destined for politics. The salient event, the important event, the seminal event, most important thing that happens really in Franklin Roosevelt's adult life is he goes swimming one day and gets a fever, falls ill, goes basically into a coma. And when he comes back, when he recovers, he is paralyzed really from the waist down. Now, for a long time, people chalk this up to polio. Polio, you probably talk to your grandparents about polio epidemics that were around when they were younger. People would close all swimming pools. It's a viral infection. It hits you just bam like that, and you get polio, and then you might be paralyzed for the rest of your life. It's not around now. You get vaccinated against it, but in the 1930s, 40s, 50s, it was a scourge until they figured out a vaccine for it. Now, some people doubt that he actually had polio. They thought maybe it was some kind of meningitis or something like that, because typically polio is something that affects children, and he was well into his 30s when he got it. But nonetheless, it paralyzed him from the waist down. And for a man who had previously been athletic and charismatic and a go-getter who had this political career in mind for himself, this is a major setback. And it's at this point that he really finds reserves of courage and willingness to go forward, fortitude, that he, you wouldn't really know you have until you've been tested this way. He basically just decides to act like nothing happened. One thing about this time is they don't have nice words for handicapped and disabled. They had cripple, and cripples don't participate in public life. So he got some leg braces, and it could prop him up, and by moving his hips, he could kind of have a semblance of walking. And as long as he was holding on to someone's arm, he was okay. People knew that he wasn't steady on his feet, but they didn't realize that he was essentially wheelchair-bound, that his legs were non-functional totally. And by the way, when you're walking with him, when he had your arm, they said it was like the death grip. He's just squeezing as hard as he can because he is so scared that he's going to fall over and just reveal how unable to move around he really is. But this really changes it. And you won't see any photographs of him in a wheelchair in the White House, none of his publicity stuff. The only time you see him in a wheelchair is when he's at Warm Springs. That's a hospital he basically founds with his own money in Georgia for people who have polio. And he's there with his little kids in his wheelchair. They saw him in his wheelchair, but the American public didn't. Now, Roosevelt doesn't have a lot of particular qualifications to be president. He's not the most accomplished guy, apart from his recovering from his personal tragedies. He hasn't really done that much. But he's a Roosevelt, and he's a Democrat in a year when people are eager to punish Republicans. And so Roosevelt, 1932, wins in a landslide. And what's his plan? Well, New Deal. Roosevelt's economic plan. What is the New Deal? Well, it's kind of not any kind of coherent thing. Roosevelt, one thing about the New Deal that historians will debate, some people will talk about when it's more organized or less organized, but Roosevelt kind of makes it up as he goes. In fact, he'll say this. Roosevelt compares himself to a quarterback. Back when quarterbacks actually used to call plays. I'm out there on the field, and I'm looking for where to throw the ball. It's my New Deal. I'm just kind of open to all possibilities. Oh, he's open like that. That's kind of what it is. Now, so if you have to sum up the New Deal in terms of strategy, overall theory, none of those things exist. The New Deal is Roosevelt's plan, and his plan is to wing it. One thing that Roosevelt is very aware of is that he doesn't know anything about an economy. Sorry, parent conference night outside. People might come walking in, so just beware of that. One thing that Roosevelt is very aware of is this psychological need to recover confidence. Economies are all based on confidence, how people will invest in the system to the degree they believe it's stable. That's part of the game, the suspension of disbelief, the willingness to everybody get back in and pretend like this stuff is real and has value and everything like that, these constructs that we have. That's why you read those speeches. We have nothing to fear but fear, but fear itself. Yeah, only kids that go to rich kid schools talk like that in America. So that's his New Deal. It's his economic plan to recover from the Great Depression and get America's economy back on track. A plan that's not really a plan. How does he tell America about this? How do people find out? Fireside chats. Roosevelt is the first president to make successful use of radio as a medium. Every week or so, people gather around the radio and Roosevelt, as if he's in your house having a chat with you, except, of course, you're not talking to him. He's just talking to you. And in very simple language, Roosevelt explains whatever his policy is that week. He gives the impression, which is really important. Don't get the idea he's just conning people. It's really important to give the impression that the people who are in power are competent, that they have a plan, and that they are figuring this out and you can trust them. Having confidence in your leaders, very important part of having confidence in your economy. So don't get the idea that Roosevelt's just kind of, blowing smoke or something like that. No. Building confidence back in the system is a big part of recovering. So if the New Deal can be said to have one consistent thing, one consistent feature, it's that government gets bigger. Roosevelt is very big on the idea of, just a managed economy. Roosevelt thinks things have been, it's been Wild West out here, really for too long. So he wants to regulate. And of course, regulating means more government agencies to do the regulating, which means a whole bunch of people hired by the government to do the regulating, which means big time jobs for college educated people who can get into the government and organize all this stuff. So anybody with a college education doesn't have a job, they flood into Washington to get one of those sweet, sweet government jobs. Now, the New Deal programs are kind of hit and miss in terms of their effectiveness and their longevity. Some of them last a year, some of them are still with us to this day. The most permanent thing about it is, of course, that expansion of government that never goes away. Government expands under Wilson, it really expands under FDR, and then it mega expands under Lyndon Johnson, who we'll talk about later on. But this is the sort of the middle stage of that, and it is quite a massive amount of growth. Some of the things Roosevelt found. Well, one thing, one of the New Deal programs that's pretty successful even to this day is the FDIC, Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation. One thing about banks is that they are allowed to lend money. Well, banks make money by lending money at interest, but they're actually able to lend out more money than would cover their deposits. In other words, five people each put $100 into the bank. The bank can loan out $300. It only has $200 on hand, but the law allows it to pretend it has all 500. Normally, that's not a problem. All five of those guys aren't going to come back trying to get their 100 bucks at the same time. If they do, though, only the first two who show up are going to get their $100. The other guys are just no more money. Sorry, that's it. Which means that if people start to panic that everybody's going to go for their money, everybody does go for their money, and that means the banks fall apart. Deposit insurance means that now that your insurance is covered, your deposits are covered by the government, and by now it's up to about $250,000. Still going on. If you go to the bank or the teller counter, it'll say FDIC insured. Your deposits are covered by the bank, which means that if the bank fails, your money doesn't disappear, which means you have no incentive to rush to the bank and pull your money out as fast as possible, which again means confidence in the long run. Some things are still with us like that. Other things like National Recovery Administration are not with us. The National Recovery Administration, the NRA, sets wage and price controls. Roosevelt believes that, well, at the heart of it, he believes that farm prices are everything. He, in his heart, believes he's a farmer because technically he owns this massive, gigantic estate in upstate New York that has farms on it. So Roosevelt believes he's a farmer, and farm prices, that's the key to having a successful economy. And so he wants to keep farm prices high. So farmers plow under their crops, make less food, means food's more expensive, which means they make money, and then trickle down to the rest of the economy in his view. Now, this only lasts about a year. The Supreme Court shuts this down. But wage and price controls are going to, you're going to see this pop up again in American history. And even with Republicans, it's not a thing that just kind of disappears. Nowadays, it's pretty much politically taboo. But even into the 70s, it was possible for the government to just say, all right, here's what meat costs, and that's what they would do. Public Works Administration set up a bunch of other sub things like Civilian Conservation Corps, stuff like that, where the government would basically hire people to work on public works projects, roads and bridges and stuff like that. And you put yourself in the position of a man in the 1930s, you can kind of see why this is psychologically important. the 1930s, your identity, your self-image as a man is bound up with your image of yourself as a provider. I'm not a rich man. I don't have millions of dollars, gigantic house, but I can feed my wife and kids. That's what makes me a man. Now, when you can't do that, when your wife's looking at you and your kids are hungry and everybody's looking at you, solve this, and you can't, that's a powerful, that is damaging, that hurts. And here comes the government and says, hey, come work for us, get a steady paycheck, feed your family again, get your manliness back, and that's a big deal. Men needed that in the 19th. Nowadays, of course, people, much less stigma attached to, accepting government assistance. But back then it was, being able to support a family. If you couldn't do that, you were just shunned by any kind of decent society. So that program, like FDIC, was really popular. It doesn't exist to this, it's not still around, but was in its day very successful and did a lot for in keeping Roosevelt in office for 4 terms. We'll see. Securities and Exchange Commission. Roosevelt believed very strongly that the stock market was just wild, out of control, and needed to be regulated. And to that end, he creates the Securities and Exchange Commission to regulate the stock market, government agency that regulates the stock market. And he employs, to that end, a guy named Joseph P. Kennedy. Now, Joseph P. Kennedy is somebody, especially that name, we're going to be seeing over and over again. Because Joseph P. Kennedy is basically the patriarch of the Kennedy political family. Joseph Kennedy comes from kind of a middle-class background in Boston, goes to Boston Latin School, School for Smart Kids, goes to Harvard on a scholarship, and gets out and, age of 25, goes to the banking business and discovers he has a real talent for making money all kinds of different ways. Into banking, gets into stocks, gets into real estate, goes out to Hollywood, decides to become a Hollywood producer and collect a bunch of movie studios and a bunch of actress girlfriends, despite having a wife and a growing family. He's really talented at making money, and he's really talented at making money any kind of way he can. He knows all the tricks. He knows all the ways to game the system. And so Roosevelt, despite not really trusting Joseph Kennedy, nor, by the way, did Joseph Kennedy trust Roosevelt, puts Kennedy in charge of the Securities Exchange Commission to clean things up. And Kennedy does a pretty good job. And for a while, his political star is really on the ascendant. He has a lot of ambitions. And then it just kind of goes crashing down in the worst way possible for him, but we'll talk about that later. Now, the other enduring feature of Roosevelt's New Deal, there's a ton of these programs. You can spend a whole semester talking about the New Deal. In fact, there are classes you can take in college where people talk about the New Deal. Social Security Act, which basically provides old age pensions. The idea is you pay into it, and then when you hit a certain age, you collect the money you paid into it from the government. Of course, the way it actually works is when they put it into place, they start cutting checks like 2 years after they pass the law. So you're not getting the money you paid into it. The people who are currently working are paying into it, and you're collecting your money, and you paid for the people who came before you. In any other context, this would be illegal, but when the government does it, it's okay. Just know that, Social Security works really well as long as the economy's growing and the population's growing. As long as there's more people working than there are on it, you're okay. When that ceases to be the case, then you have a problem, which is the case. So, you guys probably should look into that, because if you expect to get it when you're old, you want to do something. Now, so that's domestically. Does any of this stuff work? The best consensus historians can come to is sort of. Some people, you can always play the sort of negative where, well, if you hadn't done this, it would have been worse. And some people say, well, if you hadn't done this, it would have fixed it. Or if you had, you can always second guess. The best you can say about Roosevelt is that he does a fairly decent job of restoring confidence in the economy. Full employment, full economic strength doesn't return until World War II, when the manufacturing for World War II kicks in. But nonetheless, Roosevelt, at least politically, is successful in getting his way through the Great Depression. But the Great Depression isn't the only thing he has to deal with. The deteriorating situation in Europe and in East Asia is also a major problem. And ultimately, this is going to become the big test of the Roosevelt administration. The Great Depression's bad enough, but what else is going on in the 1930s, the collapse of the very fragile post-World War I social order in Europe, as well as developments in East Asia, are going to test it even more. When last we talked about Russia, for example, we talked about Lenin, we talked about the Bolsheviks coming in and taking over They murder the czar. They start murdering all kinds of people, class enemies, in order to install a communist system. The Bolsheviks become the Communist Party of the USSR, the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. Well, Lenin's only in power for a few years before he has a stroke and is bedridden and then dies. And so power, who's going to take over? Well, you got Lenin's right-hand man, a guy named Leon Trotsky. Trotsky is his top assistant, theoretician of the revolution, a man who is a philosopher as well as a man of action, creates the Red Army from nothing and leads it to victory in Russian Civil War and uses it an instrument of terror against the Russian people. Trotsky is the guy who looks like he's going to take over. Trotsky is you know, famous and brilliant and brave and has all these wonderful things going for him. One thing Trotsky doesn't have going for him, though, is patience for paperwork and bureaucracy and all that stuff. He's not really interested in the part of government where you decide who's the commissioner of cabbage and sewer system subdirector and things like that. The boring business of government he's happy to leave to other people. People like Joseph Stalin, Yosef Zhugashvili. Stalin is Lenin's dirty work. He's kind of a thug. He robs banks and murders people, stuff like that. The Bolsheviks, the Communist Party, understand Lenin, all these guys, they're a type of political gangster. It's the sort of person you're going to see over and over again in the 20th century, a guy who is a political ideologue who uses the methods of organized crime to establish his goals. Now, Stalin does all Lenin's dirty work. He's kind of a thug. Nobody really respects him that much. And because nobody really sees him as that big of a threat, and again, I'm making a complex story really simple. Because nobody really sees him as that much of a threat, Trotsky is happy to just dump all these useless government jobs on him. Well, Stalin gives all these, put him in charge of this department, he fills it with people loyal to him. That department fills it full of people loyal to him. He accumulates jobs, he accumulates followers. And when Lenin dies, Trotsky discovers, he's not quite as popular as he thought. He doesn't have any support in the government. All those guys are loyal to Stalin. So Trotsky is put in jail, he's stripped of his party membership. Stalin kicks him out of Russia, and then spends the next 20 years trying to murder him. Now, he doesn't succeed in that until the 1940s, but meanwhile, back in Russia, he murders all of Trotsky's friends, all of Trotsky's supporters, everyone he thinks might support Trotsky, everyone who he suspects in the future might support Trotsky. And then he starts murdering everyone who remembered the role Trotsky played during the Bolshevik Revolution. All the people who were there at the beginning who saw Trotsky by Lenin's side, he murders. He changes the photographs. You'll see on the slide. He literally just airbrushes Trotsky out of the past. Stalin doesn't just wage war on Trotsky in the present. He erases him from history. Stalin murders everyone. Everyone who's a threat to him, everyone who might be a threat to him, everyone who remembers a different version of history than he's trying to put forth. Slowly but surely, he wipes out all of those original revolutionaries, both secretly and openly in trials and in just, drive-by shootings. Any way he can to get rid of these guys, he does. And in the end, by the time the 1930s end, Stalin is in complete and utter control of Russia. And he signs a pact with a guy we've already met before, Adolf Hitler. Adolf Hitler's rise to power parallels Stalin's in a lot of ways. Hitler, also one of these political gangsters, comes out of the World War I obsessed with German nationalism and getting rid of that Treaty of Versailles. Moves to Munich in Germany, where he joins the German Workers' Party, which later becomes the National Socialist German Workers' Party. And in German, the acronym is Nazi. That's where that comes from. Tries to overthrow the government. That doesn't work. He ends up getting put in prison, where he's there for about 6 months before they release him. He takes the time to write Mein Kampf while he's there. And devotes himself now to electoral politics. His Nazi party wins a lot of seats in the German Reichstag. And comes to power, and people think, Hitler took over, he's a dictator and all that stuff. That happens later on, but he rose through electoral politics. When eventually he's powerful enough that he is made Chancellor of Germany through a series of deals with other parties. And in a parliamentary system, it's not like here where you win an election, your guys take over this. And In a parliamentary system, every party gets a certain number of seats, and then they, among themselves, decide who's going to get what government job. Hitler is powerful enough to insist on being made chancellor, which is kind of like prime minister of Germany, at which point he takes over, he bans all other political parties, starts throwing his people in, his enemies in jail, murdering all of his rivals within the Nazi party, and just like Stalin, seizing power in exactly the same way. And you know, they basically ally together and create a non-aggression pact. And Hitler, he just starts taking over all kinds of stuff. Hitler's big dream is to unite all German people into one government. So to that end, he wants Germany and Austria to be one country. That's against the Treaty of Versailles, but nobody stops him. Then he wants a big chunk of Czechoslovakia, the part where all the German people live. Neville Chamberlain, the British Prime Minister, goes to Munich to talk to Hitler and talk him out of it. Hitler says, well, okay, just give me the German part and it'll be fine. That's all I want from now on. Takes over that part, then just rolls on and takes over the rest of Czechoslovakia. Then it becomes pretty apparent to everyone Hitler's going to try to take over Poland. Well, Britain and France say, all right, Hitler, if you take over Poland, that's it. War's going to start. So Hitler invades Poland. Britain and France declare war on Hitler. Hitler rolls his army as fast as he possibly can into France, kind of like the old Schlieffen plan, rolls down through Belgium, encircles the French army, and takes them out in 6 weeks. So now it's basically down to Britain. Hitler, understand at this point, has gone from win to win to win, and by 1939, when World War II begins, he is gone from success after success and has no reason to believe he won't be successful in the future. And Hitler has other friends. In the Far East, you see a development, the Japanese. The Japanese people haven't really played much of a role in our story, it's U.S. history, so it's not really something we're going to get into too much, but understand that Japan, the crash course version of Japanese history. Up until 1858, Japan is essentially a feudal country. Samurai, swords, that whole thing. The Americans send over a warship to negotiate with them in 1858. Hey, we decided we're going to open up your country and trade with you. The Japanese look at this gigantic warship, steam engines, giant cannons, everything like that, and they realize we have nothing that can compete against this, and if we don't do something, we are really going to suffer for it. So just like that, they modernize. The shogun government, the military dictatorship of the samurai, is overthrown. The emperor is brought back into power. The Japanese government sends their best and brightest overseas to Britain to learn about navies, to France and Prussia to learn about armies, to America to learn about industry, factories, railroads, all that stuff. And in about 20 years, they become a major industrial power. Just bam, that quick. Like a lot of industrial powers, they are interested in expanding. England has an empire, Russia has an empire, all the other countries have empires, we should too. Not to mention the fact Japan's a very crowded country. Japan's about the size of California, but it's very mountainous, not a lot of arable land, so they want room, they want to expand their people out. And the nearest convenient place to expand is Manchuria in northern China. So the Japanese seize pretexts and they roll over into Manchuria and start taking over China and just committing horrible atrocities. The Japanese army is better organized and more successful than the Chinese army. China has basically fallen apart into warlordism at this point. It's in bad shape. And Japan is really able to do this. And in Japan, there's this glorification of war and violence and conquest. That old Bushido samurai code didn't go away when the samurai went away. The samurai just rolled into the army and brought it with them. Only now it's wedded to this fanatical nationalism, the same kind of thing you see in Germany. So they go into China and just commit horrible atrocities. They use poison gas and biological weapons on civilians, rape, murder, looting, all horrible things, done with the full connivance of the Japanese government, even though the Japanese government isn't always in control of what happens. One of the scary things about World War II you're going to see is that, you know, who's in charge of Germany? Hitler. Who's in charge of Russia? Stalin. Who's in charge of Japan? Not really anybody, clearly. The army kind of does what it wants. The navy does what it wants. Sometimes they cooperate, sometimes they don't. Sometimes people ask the emperor's permission before they do things, sometimes they ask it after. It's not that he's unwilling to go along with a lot of this stuff, but he's not always consulted. So Japan's a lot more chaotic than these other countries are. The Rape of Nanking, great example of that. I wouldn't say great, but an example of that, in a great sense of fitting, not a good thing, obviously. Something like 300,000 civilians murdered in Nanking. A brutal bloodbath. The Japanese go into the city of Nanking and just murder people. Beheading contests, babies tossed in the air and caught on bayonets. An absolute just inhuman. And people in America are watching all of this. They're seeing newsreels of this happening every time they go to the theater. News from the Far East. Oh, look what these people are doing in China. And it horrifies the American public. And the American public, wants something done about this. And Roosevelt embargoes the Japanese. Roosevelt says, you guys, we're not going to sell you, we're not going to sell you rubber for your tires. We're not going to sell you cloth for uniforms. We're not going to sell you all these things. Japan doesn't have any natural resources. They cannot keep a modern army in the field without imports. So as Roosevelt's administration chips away at what can be sold to Japan, the Japanese realize that slowly but surely, when they start cutting off, they cut off oil, the Japanese realize that we've really only got two options here. One, pull back on the militarism, on the glorification of war and violence and everything like that. Or we need a new source of materials. Now, as it happens, Indonesia's to the south. There's plenty of oil there. The Philippines, there's lots of places to get this stuff. They're just controlled by other people. If we attack Indonesia, for example, then that puts us at war with the Dutch. If we're at war with the Dutch, we're also at war with the British, which means we're almost certainly also at war with America. Now, there is very little appetite for war in America at this point. You have things, for example, like the America First Committee, a broad-based, nonpartisan organization that is firmly against America getting involved militarily with any of the stuff that's happening in Japan or Europe or anything. America First is proudly anti-war. They want to keep America out of it. So there's this anti-war mood in America. The Japanese kind of sense this, but a lot of it just has to do with their prejudice. They really believe that America, if they're attacked and attacked hard, will give up. America is not a nation of warriors. America is a nation of, grocery store owners and businessmen, people who in their society are looked down on as weak and don't have the manly virtues necessary for war and destruction, things like that. So the Japanese don't think much of America in terms of our fighting spirit. So, if the Japanese are able to knock out America's ability to respond quickly to their aggression, then they'll be able to just roll right over all those islands in the Pacific, take over everything they need, and by the time America's ready to come back and do something, the Japanese will be so secure in their position that the Americans won't be able to do anything. And thus, they plan the attack on Pearl Harbor. We talked about Hawaii last time. We talked about imperialism. We talked about Hawaii and why it's so important right there in the middle of the Pacific. It's a great place to, strategic place to station your Navy, which is what they have. The Americans who are in Hawaii don't have a tremendous a lot of respect for the abilities of the Japanese. They believe their ships are safe because the harbor is too shallow for torpedoes to operate effectively. They don't realize the Japanese have constructed torpedoes that will do this. They are also kind of contemptuous of the Japanese pilots' ability, airplane pilots' ability to attack, and even though the Japanese have fielded the best fighter so far in the war, the Mitsubishi Zero. And so the Japanese, when they decide to launch the attack on Pearl Harbor, they set sail from Japan in complete radio silence, crossing thousands of miles of ocean. They make their way to Hawaii. When they get there on the morning of December 7th, 1941, they launch an air attack, an utter surprise attack on the American Navy at Pearl Harbor, killing about 2,500 American sailors, wounding another 1,500. Until 9/11, it was the worst attack on American soil ever. It's completely treacherous. It's a total backstab, something that's not done in any kind of laws of international warfare, any kind of custom, and a complete miscalculation on the part of the Japanese. Kind of like we saw with Fort Mims and the Red Sticks back last semester, where they massacre these people, thinking that, okay, well, that's going to show them. They're not going to come. These are not people who are warriors. These are people who are peaceful men. They don't have the warrior virtues. If they attack us, it'll be just like a raid, just like we did to them. They have no idea what they've unleashed. the America goes from being a country that's pretty solidly anti-war to overnight unleashing its full material, industrial, and rage-fueled fury against the Japanese people. The war you're going to see in the Pacific is far worse in terms of the bloodbath that ensues. And we're going to talk about that after we talk about World War II in Europe. So, I got through in about 38 minutes, so that's pretty good, I think. If you have any questions about anything, obviously, you know what? If you have questions about it, when we do the next video, bam, you can ask me about that then. So, this is Mr. Mumma saying thank you for watching. I'll see you all later, and have fun.